नमस्ते लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, एस्पायरिंग डांसर्स, मेडिकल प्रोफेशनल्स, साइंटिस्ट्स, स्कॉलर्स इन देयर रेस्पेक्टिव डोमेन्स। सो फार आई वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट द वेरियस एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ ओम साउंड एंड निर्विकल्प समाधि, विकल्प समाधि एंड द साउंड एंड द वाइब्रेशनल पार्ट, वाइब्रेशनल एप्लीकेशंस ऑफ इंडिविजुअल as to how exactly it works about. In this video, let's get much further and try to understand the gist of the subject with regards to meditation. Meditation, again, go parallel with yoga as a whole. Yoga, as I was trying to talk in reference to dance and music, fine arts and culture as such, respectively, to understand in brief. However, I touched upon meditation as well, wherein I was talking about praying on the formless and the form as such. Vikalpa, nirvikalpa. This is where it happens. Now let's talk about meditation. Before even getting to four types of meditation, meditational practices, what is meditation and why do one need to do meditation? Let me talk from the audience point of view, then I will talk from the dancer's point of view and dancer and musicologist point of view. From the audience point of view, it's plain and simple. He or she takes a point, either it could be Bindu, either it could be like concentrating on one point, which is called Bindu, which is what is called Nada Bindu, by chanting Om. Om. Here is what you are actually trying to meditate on, Om, and trying to get that concentration level to a single point of contact, that is the, which is what is called Agya Chakra. This is where you try to get those energy levels in the meditation. Now there are two forms, there are two ways of looking at the God's creation. One is formed, which is having form, other is formless. To do the formless meditation, you require a lot of practice. It doesn't come in a single day's time, ladies and gentlemen. Let's be very clear on this. I have seen many of the yoga practitioners, many of the meditation practitioners, many of the institutions who are talking about this, by and large, telling that it is possible and it will happen in due course of time. Please, let's not be under the wrong impression that the formless meditational practice happens only through long penance and long practice. Today it has been for me 45. I'm 45 now. I started doing meditation way back around 15th year, even much before that, when I was in my 12th year. I always used to sit for some time and do the meditation. It's like 20, I would rather say 33 years that I could get that concentration level today. Even today, to get to that formless level, first I need to get to that form, formally thinking of the God, and then get to that formless level. This is what is very important factor for a meditational practitioner. Please understand this. Try not to be under misconception. I have seen many of them coming up with a kind of thinking, with a kind of saying that you will get nirvana in half an hour's time. Please try to understand, meditation is a divine practice. It requires a lot of concentration. Okay, now let's try. So far I was talking about the formless and form meditation. In the formless, you take nada bindu or the bindu, a point, and concentrate and try to get that into this point, agya chakra. Then you, the energy starts getting distributed at the mooladhara and then reaches to this level. And this is the ultimate level where one can really look at. For a classical dancer, it's a very easy task, but he or she needs to do it diligently and understand it. Okay. Now, in the form, you tend to think as if you are near the God. Whatever deity you are, say Ramana Maharshi or whatever, whomsoever you think is your guru, or if it is Lakshmi Narasimha Swami, it is Shiva, it is Parvati, it could be even Lalita Devi, because I normally go with Lalita Devi, because I believe in Lalita Devi, I don't believe in any other God, because that has been, it has been my practice from my childhood as such. Let's talk about four types of meditation. Meditation of specific form or divine form. Divine form or specific form means over here having the concentration level putting up on, let's say, Sai Baba or any kind of God, and trying to get that positive energy by sitting calm and silent. This is what is called form, because you tend to have think about the structure. This is how it would be like. Got it? So this is what is specific form. It has certain specific form that you are thinking about. Let's say Lalita Devi. Lalita Devi has for one conch and sugar cane. And you tend to describe that image within yourself and start concentrating. Meditation on his or her qualities. It's like you zero your mind there. You start reflecting yourself. You start questioning yourself. Who am I? What am I? Whatever qualities I have, are those good or bad? You tend to do that self-interrogation by staying calm. This is what is called the meditation on his or her internal qualities. Meditation on his divine sport. It could be Leela or it could be joyful. Meditation on his or divine sport. This divine sport, this is again the advanced level of meditation. When I say advanced level, once you start practicing, once you start understanding how, what is it and what is it that is happening, how do you really look at and what is the practice that I have done? Let's say I have been practicing, as I told you, for 33 years. I can think about this divine sport. I can really get into this Leela or the joyful mode where I can concentrate myself. I may be watching TV, I may be watching any kind of sport, I may be doing anything, but internally I could develop that over a period of time. This is the advanced level. This is where the attachment and detachment concept comes into picture. You stay detached though you are in this worldly affairs. Ladies and gentlemen, understand this. This is the very important point which one needs to understand during the meditation practice. Meditation on services to him. What do you understand by services? Services could be like bhakti tattva. It's like serving whenever there is a puja, whenever there is some kind of ritual happening, whenever there is some kind of yajna or homa happening, you go there, you serve, and you give whatever you want to the people who are performing yajnas or homas. This is what is called service. This is one kind of service. Other kind of service in a temple, cleaning the temple, giving prasad, etc., etc. That is one kind of service. And the other kind of service, preparing the prasad at your home and giving to the temple and serving to the poor, that is also one kind of service. And helping the needy and needy ones, helping someone who has come to you and asking for what you call food and you are serving him, that is also a service. Guiding the people, etc., etc., etc. So these are what you call services. This is also one kind of meditational practice, which is very easy to be practiced. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. This is the practical importance of meditation. In this video, the pointers or the takeaways for the individuals is understanding the types of meditations and what are the meditational practices, and most importantly, the advanced level, that is meditation on his divine sport, Leela or joyful. That is very important to be understood. This is more easier for a classical dancer to understand, in my view, because classical dancer tends to do those steps or do the movements by imagining himself, surrendering himself or herself to the God, and he or she performs on the stage, listening to the lyrics. Ladies and gentlemen, understand this. This is for specifically for classical dancers and classical musicians. This will be more easier for them. I wouldn't say it would be tough for a non-performer, but for a non-performer, it requires some practice. For a dancers, for classical dancers and classical musicologists, it's very easy. They can get into that play. Before even talking about the subject much further, let me talk about certain rituals, certain practices, certain actions which used to happen during the medieval period of times or prehistoric times to avoid any kind of natural calamities like this. However, note and a disclaimer over here. They had the tenacity, they had that authenticity, they had that guilelessness attitude, they had that divinity, they had that purity, they had that parity within themselves. It's not that they used to do it just for the heck of doing it. In fact, I followed those principles for quite a long time during my childhood. I remember lighting a lamp. I remember using turmeric powder or the haldi powder. Of course, in the conservative atmosphere, it was hard for me to explain certain things and certain habits of mine, because nobody tries to understand or whatever it is. Today, in the 21st century, life has become a very complex and most sophisticated life. I really wonder, if we are going on a right path at first place, defying the old traditions, whatever that is being that I was speaking about in my previous videos was in connection with the old traditions. However, I wanted to add a few more points to this as a part of factors or the cofactors. When I say cofactors or factors, these are the primary guidelines, I would rather say. It's like a systematized and a schematic approach towards this. I sometimes laugh at, and I sometimes even cry at, the way our society is taking this philosophical and the spiritual approach in a way. Sad, but truth has to be told. Today, society is thinking from his or her own point of view. I dare challenge on this. When we are doing any kind of rituals, when we are doing any kind of spiritual practices, one needs to have the due commitment. One needs to have the due endurance. One needs to have the guilelessness. One needs to understand that it is not only the karta who will be benefited out of this. Even the outsiders will be benefited out of it. It's a $1,000 billion question. How many of us really think from the point of view of dharmo rakshati rakshitaha? If only society had thought about it. Dharmo rakshitare rakshitaha. Whatever yajnas or homas that are being performed to this day, there would have been solution for this virus or the negative effect of the atmospheric kind of thing. In the good old days, if I go back to mythological era, or the prehistoric era, they had that guilelessness and they had that divinity, they had that tenacity, they had that authenticity within themselves. They were so diligent that they were ready to sacrifice themselves. How many of us are really ready to sacrifice is the question. It has to be questioned by one and all. Clapping and lighting a lamp with the Vedic chantings, or keeping silent. What really does that mean? Have we ever thought? Clapping is equivalent to having that equilibrium force acting in the universe. Our five hands are the panchabhutas and the panchakoshas. The moment you clap, there is an energy that gets released, positive energy within yourself, in and around yourself. However, as I said, it has to be pure. It has to come from the purified mindset. Just because someone has told if we are doing it does not make any sense. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. There is biggest spiritual realm behind clapping of hands or behind ringing the bell in the temple. Unfortunately, due to this pandemic situation, our government is not allowing to go to the temples to get that positive energy within ourselves. There also we tend to create that negative energy. I need it, I need it, I need it. It really pains to tell me that, tell this, ladies and gentlemen. We have failed literally to understand the Vedas and Upanishads. Coming to the lighting of lamp, this is what is called Akhanda Jyoti. This Jyoti is always lit. And it has to be, it will be there in everyone by default. What I fail to understand is, just because Modi ji has told you are burning the lamp and you are putting it and you are taking selfies, etc., etc., what not. We have done many things. No, that is not the way divine nature responds to you. Divinity comes if it is selfless and it is guileless. It has to have the element of genuinity and diligence. Even if you are chanting a mantra, it has to have that. Staying silent, staying calm during the lighting of lamp, just because he has told, does not work. Here, staying silent and staying calm means it's a self-introspection, thinking within you, who am I, what am I, how do I do? It's like developing a kind of positive attitude in yourself. Ladies and gentlemen, understand this. The exercise and the phenomena behind this, of both of these acts. Asatoma sadgamaya tamasoma jyotirgamaya mrityorma amritam gamaya. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwarha, Gurur Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Sthavaram Jangamam Vyaptam Yena Characharam Tatpadam Darshitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. The lamp denotes Guru. You are trying to appease Guru. You are telling Guru, Namaskaram. I pray my obeisance. I give my obeisance to you. Kindly help this society to come out of this pandemic situation. Has to be the prayer. If only the prayer is diligent and all, there would not have been selfies or whatever it is. I see many of them mocking. Of course, we cannot stop kids. Kids have their own way of expressing. What is that elderly people are doing? Or parents of the kids doing? It's a prime responsibility of parents to teach or show them. When we chant a mantra, there are some strong vibrations happening, which has certain set of frequencies, due to which there will be some sort of reactions happening within our body. As I am talking about panchakoshas, using the sensory object five senses, which is what creates that kind of energy levels. Which is a part of yoga as a whole. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. And then in fact, this happens in a classical dance form as well, in the classical music form as well. However, that's a different subject which will be dealt in later part of my subject. Since I am stipulating to this, I am speaking about this. So let's try understanding this in depth, ladies and gentlemen. Clapping hands and lighting a lamp or the Akhanda Jyoti within you. Putting the paste of the turmeric powder on your doorsteps and washing your doorsteps with the cow dung paste. What do you really think happens over here? What is it that is happening over here? One needs to really understand this, ladies and gentlemen. There is a practical significance behind this. Turmeric powder is a strong antidote for these all kinds of viruses that are there in the nature. And even the cow dung paste, the liquid state of the cow dung, when we scatter at the doorsteps, all kinds of effects will go off. Not only that, even the design, which we say it as rangoli, which we do near to the house, has that significance. Is it that we have forgotten about it, or is it that we are ignorant about it? I don't know. Though this is just a video which I wanted to present and give these facts, let the society know about it, as to what really happened during that 9 minutes time. Just because he had told, doing it will not make any sense. I was just watching Sadhguru's comments on this, or Sadhguru's commentary on this, as to what is the practical importance. He is correct. Just for 9 minutes, so in a 1 day's time, if you are doing it, will this pandemic situation will go away? No. If you are doing it, if you are lighting the lamp every day with the guileless nature and helping nature diligently, that's when your prayers will work. However, if you are doing it just for the heck of doing it, it will not work. Ladies and gentlemen, understand this. There is a practical reason behind this. However, I conclude this video with a positive note and the pointers for the viewers, individuals. Of the practical importance of lighting the lamp and clapping, and what is it that happens? What is the phenomena behind this? It's only not only for 9 minutes for that one day. But it has to be done religiously over a period of time for some days. That's when the negative energy or the negative force goes. To whatever that I was speaking about the rituals or the practical applications of the daily day-to-day activities that we do over as a part of our practice, the moment we get up or the moment our daily routine happens. And I was speaking about lighting of the lamp, or I was speaking about the lighting of the lamp and clapping and other various factors and cofactors which influence the universe as well as the society as well as the individuals living in the society as a human being, irrespective of gender, whether he or she or any living being or any kind of animals, etc., etc. Let's not take into consideration how far it is going to affect and how effective it will be if he or she follows. The point is, one needs to understand these rituals and these practices to the core. What really it does to our body, mind, and soul. However, my core subject is all about talking from the dance and music point of view. Here, there are two aspects. When I talk about dance and music has two different versions. One, the individual taking classical dance from the yoga point of view, and the spiritual and philosophical aspects of performing the mudras during the performance is one of the aspects. The other aspect, if he or she is not following the rituals or he or she has not understood this thing from the spiritual or philosophical point of view and he or she is performing, then also the effect will be there, but not to an extent what an individual who is practicing from the yoga point of view. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. And that is one reason why today scientists or the medical professionals have understood this, the practical importance of this. And they started looking at Natya Shastra from various corners. It's a specific doctrine. Though it's a doctrine for dance, but still it holds good for the daily ritualistic practices. Understanding the highest cosmic energy levels, how they impact, how they work. This is where a teacher or the scholar or the guru who is teaching dance ability comes into picture. He or she needs to understand what is the practical implications to the core, to the deeper aspect. When I say deeper, the in-depth analysis. It not only purifies your body, mind and soul, but it touches your panchakoshas, your panchabhutas. It touches your shat chakras, the 7 layers of the 39 layers that are present in our body. Specifically, when he or she gets to the Agya Chakra, between Agya Chakra and Sahasrara Chakra, that is from here to here, we have 19 layers present. It even purifies that. That is a self-realization point. And that's when the negative energies get killed. Here it is where the negative energies get killed. The moment it touches the body, it directly goes and it gets it killed over here. And that's when the negative energies do not really affect the individual. Though one may argue, he or she could not get that ailment and all. And I have seen enough of cases where dancer even died when performing. And this is where actually I see in Swarna Kamalam, one of the movies of Vishwanath sir, where the dancer dances and he dies on the stage. Again, one may say it's again the karmic deeds that happen. That's a different aspect altogether. But then, with utmost diligence and utmost selflessness, guilelessness, spirituality, the philosophical understanding, he had been practicing it. And he could do justice to that. However, one may argue on this, that, hey man, how are you telling that? This classical dance, if practiced from the yoga point of view and understanding each and every step, each and every karna, each and every mudra, from a very point, purify the nature in and around you and outside the boundaries also. Yes, it purifies. But one needs to have that purity and parity when he or she is dancing. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. That is the reason why Bharata's first part, Bharata divided this into two parts, this doctrine usage. He says it can be used from the yoga therapeutic point of view. And on the other hand, he says this acts as a healing for entertainment, from the entertainment point of view, which clears half of the healings. Yes, it is. If one sees from the yoga point of view and practices, it always gives a vivid and wider aspect to the classical dance form. If one sees from the entertainment point of view also, it gives, because he gets that happiness, the mind's restlessness and the cognition of the mind clears off, due to which there won't be any sort of ailments, and due to which he or she will be free from all the apathies. Specifically, when we talk about vitarkas and vikshepas, we have many tarkas. Tarka is nothing but, the true meaning of tarka is giving excuses to all the rituals. Vitarka is nothing but understanding the reason behind that and implementing it. You don't argue baselessly there, you will have a base there and thus implement it. Today, the tarka aspect and vitarka aspect of the religious practices or the religion or the philosophies, be it Vedic philosophy and Upanishadic philosophy, be it Westerners philosophy, be it any kind of philosophy, they are giving their own explanations, forgetting of the fact that doctrines have laid down certain set of procedures or the schematic approach or the systematic way, which has certain yoga benefits or etc., etc. Why are we not really looking at it? Has always been my question. And today we have, for one commentary, let's take Ramayana or Mahabharata, we have many versions to it and we are forgetting it. At the same time, we have pseudo gurus, or I would say rogue gurus, or social elements who are trying to exercise their own way of presenting the philosophy or the spiritual practices. It's the sad truth. It's the hardest truth which one needs to understand, due to which Swadharma is taking place instead of Dharma. Dharma as a standard set of systematic approach and schematic approach. Unfortunately, Dharma is missing and we are seeing Swadharma, due to which the nature is acting upon, which is indirectly creating havoc in the society as well as individual soul existence. In fact, I am happy for the fact that Modi ji has got two very vital points. One is clapping of hands and lighting of the lamp. He has done a very good thing by enlightening the society. Understand this. This is where our philosophy and spiritual aspects come into picture. I am thankful to Modi ji for the same. How destructive the universe will be in case if we are defying or not complying with the nature which has given a proper guidelines and proper schematic and proper systematic approach towards the personal growth. At the same time, vikshepas are nothing but your flaws or your shortcomings as an individual. You have various kinds of you have various kinds of shortcomings which we do not want to focus upon. Thankful to this virus, it has given enough of opportunity for the individuals to look upon. If these individuals are not really looking at it or peeping into this aspect, that means they have wasted their 21 days time. Quarantine is nothing but over here looking at yourself and seeing what best you could do to come out. And these negative energies or the viruses or whatever it is will not affect you in case you have a systematized and schematic approach in understanding yourself in practicing rituals. One need not do it for lifetime. But in case if you are doing it for 21 days, that's enough. In the good old days, the count for doing all the rituals and understanding yourself and practicing and creating that positive energy within you and in the universe was 21 days, 41 days, 11 days, 21 days, 41 days or mandala kala and 108 days, that is 108 beats, 108 days and above. Some people even used to practice for 365 days, 1 year period. In fact, for your information, I have had practiced whole of this philosophy, whatever Modi ji had told sometime back, for close to 8 months. 8 months, believe me, I used to clean the metal idols of Ayyappan. I used to do Abhisheka. I used to clean everything, that worshipping place, with water. I used to sit near the Yajna or Homa with all kinds of metals or all kinds of materials, and I could see that reaction happening. Believe me, once you start practicing whole of this, your body will get that immunity factor. Your body will be away from whole of the negative energies. Your body will have those positive energies coming within you. Whatever negative energy that is there will go off. Not only that, even your mind gets purified. Your mind will have positive thoughts. And in fact, when I started, I used to think, I need this, I need that, I need this, I need that, I want to be this, I want to be that. But after some time, I thought, whole of this practice is nothing but to help the society to grow and you yourself to grow. It was like Tarka happening with me in my mind, and Vitarka took over that. It explained me in various ways and it cleansed my Vikshepas as such. And in fact, this is what happens in classical dance form. If you try to understand from the yoga point of view, need not necessarily you practice it. You do it for entertainment. Don't worry about it. But still, understand the core concept of it. Explain them. But still, you will get those benefits out of it. Today, the dearth is a situation that we are not understanding. We are thinking classical dance for the entertainment aspects or the classical music for the entertainment aspects. It has spiritual and philosophical background as well. Even yagyas or homas, which are being performed, does really have that practical significance. It goes to everyone. And that is the reason why yagyas and homas were performed on a regular day-to-day basis in the prehistoric time, right from Indus Valley civilization. Even today, Iranians perform yagya to the fire god and then start their thing. I cannot give any more example to this. So thus, I conclude this video with a positive note to understand Tarka and Vitarka and the Vikshepas to the highest level, in the deeper and in-depth aspect of it. Try to understand it. And even for the dancers, the takeaway from this video is understanding of Tarka and Vitarka and Vikshepas in the body, and understanding dance from the yoga point of view. Need not necessarily you have that approach, because not everyone can withhold that power. But still understand it. Various kinds of apathies, calamities, disorders, ailments happening over a period of time for almost like close to maybe now, maybe it's like my 45th year, which I have been seeing from my 12th year or 13th year or the 13th birthday. I have been seeing this happening, these epidemics or various ailments happening at various junctures. Things have been changing for every maybe like 50 years, 100 years now. The society changes, environmental changes, out of which major which I had seen was anthrax way back around 20 or 25 years when I was doing my schooling or college days, or and then saw ozone layer getting teared off, and saw other epidemics which had on a frequent basis disturbed economic system as a whole. Be it recession, be it closing of the companies, be it laying off. It's nothing new to me as such. I as an individual really thought about it way back around 25 years. Where exactly this society is moving towards, or whatever ailments that are happening. What could be the possible reasons for this? In fact, I had suffered the same kind of issues in my environment, in and around my environment, and even outside. It's not only me as an individual suffering, but like me, there are many of them, like mushrooms. Nobody is able to figure out as to what exactly happens. However, today I got introduced to the advanced level of yoga practice, or the spiritual practices, or the understanding of the spiritual realms at a deeper and in-depth aspects. What I could understand was a couple of things. Though I had explained in detail what exactly happens with the structure and the schematic way of structuring or realigning or restructuring your emotional intelligence or the intelligence capacity, which directly affects the mind. What I could understand was, mind is one thing that plays the key role. Be it environmental disasters, be it societal disasters, be it ecological disasters. Everything is related, directly related to the human existence on this earth. In fact, I had seen forests being burnt, specifically in the Western countries. I had seen certain forests being taken to a ride, even the environment taken to a ride. Though we practice meditation and other yoga practices and all, the thing is, why I am talking about this is, human consciousness has that limitations. When I say human consciousness has that limitations, human being is one of the sole individual responsible for whole of this socio-economic reforms, development, or ecological development. However, one may say calamities happen due to the existence of the universe, and they are supposed to happen. But according to me, if you ask me, it is human consciousness or human being who has that capability to stop these calamities or whatever ecological system or ecological imbalance, specifically when it comes to nature. Nature has to be enjoyed. It is not that we destroy it. There has been quite a lot of destruction in the name of religion, in the name of ritual practices, etc., etc. If I name, it would be a 100 pages book. Now let's try understanding Bodhi and Pragya, which is what develops once you get into the Samadhi state. Bodhi means one's Buddhi. Once usage and applications or the applicability of the mind with the right spirit. When I say right spirit, it has to have purity and parity. And pragya, wisdom. These are the two factors which drive the human consciousness or the human system as an individual. However, these two are the key factors or the cofactors that drive one's thoughts in a more positive direction. Once we start using it, using this conscious human consciousness or the human mind in a more positive way, that gives the effect to the society as well as the civilization, which is increasingly going at a higher speed, rapid speed. One needs to understand at a very minutest point that the wisdom that you gain, the buddhi or the thought process that you gain, has to be used in a more positive way. Today, most of us face that practical difficulties, those difficulties, only for a simple reason that we are not using this wisdom or the buddhi or the human intelligence, emotional intelligence, at a right spirit. When I say right spirit, with the purity and the parity way. One needs to have this because whole of our ecological system is based on these two pillars. Understand this. If one says it does not have any references, I am ready to have an argument on this. If only human beings are conscious about their efforts in putting their wisdom and the buddhi in a right way, in a systematic and schematic way, he or she would have enjoyed the universe creation, beautification, the beautiful universe. He or she would not have burnt the forest, which happened in Australia, wherein 40% of the population of the koalas got perished. Not only koalas, even various other animals which do not have any means of telling that I am in trouble. Not only that, even usage of perfumes, etc., etc. That is one reason why today we are facing that ecological imbalance. It was already told when the ozone layer was getting teared off during that period of time. Let's try understanding this in a different perspective. During the old medieval times, prehistoric times, or Ramayana or Mahabharata, the ecological system was balanced. They didn't have the destructive thought process. They enjoyed it. They enjoyed it to the core. They made it a point to understand that ecological system is directly related to the human consciousness. And they use those yogic powers to safeguard it, rather than using for themselves. Of course, trees do have life. One needs to understand how to use it. God has given us enough of mind, or enough of buddhi, or enough of intellectual level with the yoga practices. Of the Navanidha Bhakti, dance and music has that capability. Dance and music has two aspects of it. One is entertainment aspect, other is the yoga aspect. If we take yoga from the yoga point of view, it serves the purpose of balancing the ecological system as a whole, generating that positive energy. From the entertainment point of view, also it happens. The individual who sees gets that soothing effect. His mind will be purified. His mind will be in pure and parity way. And he or she gets very good thoughts. He or she does not think in a destructive way. He or she would think in a constructive way. What is the best I can do? And yajnas and homas were being performed. Today also they are being performed. But there has to be, like, yajnas and homas are performed because this ecological system should have that balancing effect. That is the sole reason why yajnas and homas are performed. And the kind of materials that are used during the performance of rituals give those actions and reactions in the universe. Unfortunately, we are missing on that today. And that is a reason why today we are finding that ecological imbalance or the environmental changes or the, you know, various kinds of ailments are happening. Ladies and gentlemen, do understand this, the practical importance of this. The pointers from this video are understanding the wisdom and buddhi or the intellect from the viewpoint of saving the ecological system or the universe by generating that positive energy within oneself. If one can generate that positive energy, who is doing it? Be it through classical dance, be it through listening to music, be it through yajnas or be it homas, whatever it is. Believe me, today, the kind of situation that we are in, we will not be there. It would have saved. Thus, I conclude this video with a positive note. Stay blessed. Have a blissful life. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Have a nice day.